Hello everyone, and welcome back to the third module of this course on community rights and forest governance. You're now learning how communities living in forested landscapes can use the law to participate in governance of that land. As part of that, you've already learned how they can participate in decisions to divert forest land for non-forest purposes and in decisions to create inviolate spaces for conservation. You will now learn in this lecture about how they can participate in the governance of those areas after those decisions have been made. Let's first consider decisions to divert forest land for non-forest purposes. As you know, depending on the amount of forest land in question and the type of land use proposed, different types of proposals go through different levels of scrutiny under the procedure laid out in the rules made under the Forest Conservation Act. We learnt that at the end of the third stage of that procedure, final approval is given to a proposal along with a set of conditions that the user agency must fulfill. Compliance with these conditions is an aspect of governance that local communities can monitor and even help enforce with the support of some institutions.
In instances where the state government has given Section 2 permission under the Forest Conservation Act, the two documents will be extremely crucial for you. One document is the Stage 2 forest clearance by the Ministry of Environment and Forest, because it comes with a host of conditions of what all needs to be done prior to, prior to starting activity or during the operations of a mine or a port or a hydroelectric power station. The state government also can retain the central government conditions and add on more. So it's important to actually have both those documents in front of you to know what are the host of conditions that you have, which the forest diversion is dependent upon. A violation of those conditions could lead to penalties, could lead to even revocation of the forest clearance if they're not complied with. So that is what is there. At any given point of time, during the operations of a plant, if you realize that some of the information that was granted or provided by the applicant as part of the forest diversion process has been false or malafide, it is always a good opportunity to raise that. You could raise that with the regulatory authorities, or you could raise that even with as part of a judicial process, saying that the basis on which the approval was granted was faulty, and that is why it is being contested. After the final Stage 2 approval is in place, it would be important to actually understand the host of conditions that you have. And each condition would have a corresponding authority that would be responsible for it. For instance, if there is a condition related to encroachment, no further encroachments on the forest land, then the requisite authority would be the forest department. If, say, a project is using more land than actually that has been prescribed as part of it. As people living in an area or traveling to an area, often people know that this is the kind of boundaries that, a village boundary or the forest area boundary, etc. If you don't, then there's always scope of taking assistance from people who could use some equipment to, measure boundaries, etc. There are mechanisms to do that. Photographic evidence is always very useful to find out whether there is construction that has taken place outside the designated area or not. Forest diversion permissions also would come with very clear conditions in terms of sometimes on related to water or movement of wildlife, and actually trying to map that, saying that, if there is, say, the forest diversion permission says that the wildlife management plan has to be adhered with, and who are the agencies responsible for it. A closer scrutiny of what that wildlife management plan actually really tries to say and who are the agencies responsible would be useful to report any instances where that management plan has not been applied, or the management measures prescribed in the management plan are not adequate. So these are spaces to actually try and mitigate and minimize impacts, even after a project operation is in place. Similarly, when it comes to the Forest Rights Act, some approvals, earlier approvals, actually have said very clearly that, for instance, in the case of the, in case of the POSCO steel plant in port, there was one condition very clearly which said the Forest Rights Act would be the recognition of forest rights would continue to take place even after the approval. So I think some of all those things will need to be reconciled between stage one and stage two. Now, even if you, there might have been a grievance in between these two phases that had not been adhered to, even after stage two, if there are grievances, you could continue to raise some of those as part of this process. There is no bar. You know, the advantage is that because there is no prescribed process of what the grievance redressal is, you could be actually as innovative as possible in terms of highlighting the kind of grievances that arise out of in this process.
So that is how a community can participate in the governance of forest areas even after it has been diverted for non-forest purposes. Let us now look at how the same can be done in the management of forests. First, we will look at the management of areas that have not necessarily been earmarked for conservation under the Wildlife Protection Act or under the Forest Rights Act. As you know, forests in India are managed by state forest departments under working plans. These plans are approved and their implementation monitored by the Union Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. The National Working Plan Code of the Ministry is the document that sets out a standard format for all working plans across all states and union territories in India. It recommends that all working plans should be in consonance with general village-based planning. For the involvement and benefit of local stakeholders, micro plans have to be prepared for joint forest management by the members of joint forest management committees with the broad prescriptions of working plan. Under the policy of joint forest management, communities organize themselves into JFM committees, usually known as a forest protection committee, to protect and manage nearby forests, guided by locally prepared bylaws and micro plans. Communities benefit from joint forest management through direct access and control to the use and sale of most non-timber forest produce and a share in the income from timber as well. But these powers of the forest departments and the obligations and privileges of forest dwelling communities under joint forest management policies need to be read with some of their rights and powers under the Forest Rights Act. As you have learned, the community rights of forest dwellers include nistar rights, which are traditional rights to use forest produce, rights of ownership over minor forest produce that has been traditionally collected within or outside village boundaries, and the rights of access to collect, use and dispose of such produce, rights to use the products of water bodies such as fish, rights to graze cattle, and rights to protect, regenerate or conserve or manage any community forest resource which they have been traditionally protecting and conserving for sustainable use. Minor forest produce includes all non-timber forest produce of plant origin such as bamboo, wax, tendu or kendu leaves, medicinal plants and herbs, roots, tubers and the like. After community rights of ownership over minor forest produce were recognized in the Forest Rights Act, the monopoly rights of forest departments and their trade in many states have become illegal. Rights holders have the rights, either as individuals or as cooperatives or federations, to undertake individual or collective processing, value addition, and marketing of minor forest produce. Any fees or other charges placed on these activities, such as fees imposed on the transport of minor forest produce under transit rules in some states, are also illegal. That is because, unlike the privileges and concessions granted to them for accessing minor forest produce under joint forest management policies, these are actual ownership rights recognized in a law made by Parliament. These rights can be claimed before a court of law. Especially since the coming into force of the Forest Rights Act, communities have used these rights to earn revenue from trade in minor forest produce such as bamboo and tendu leaf. In some areas, the Gram Sabhas have made strict rules to regulate any indiscriminate harvesting and other ecologically destructive practices and put in place long-term plans to regenerate degraded forest areas. Apart from the recognition and vesting of these rights, the Forest Rights Act also set up, as we have learnt, democratic procedures for decision-making at the level of settlements, with the Gram Sabha playing a central role. To better understand these governance powers, we can also look at the rules made under the Forest Rights Act in 2007. For example, people and communities with forest rights and the Gram Sabha have the powers and duties to protect wildlife, forests, and biodiversity, and to exercise that power, Gram Sabhas can constitute committees for the protection of wildlife. The conservation and management plans made for community forest resources have to be integrated with the conservation and management plans of forest departments. The decisions made by these committees regarding transit permits, the use of the income from the sale of the produce, and the modification of management plans have to be approved by the Gram Sabhas. The operation of these rights and powers of governance, however, have not been quite harmonious. It has come into conflict with the parallel system of joint forest management and the powers of the forest departments and other laws that have provided for the state control and regulation of minor forest produce.
The Forest Rights Act has a provision under Section 3, Subsection 1, Clause I. The management of forests is enshrined through Gram Sabhas. It is very much possible within sanctuaries and national parks to bring forests and Adivasis closer. Section 3, Subsection 1 and Clause C provides for their rights to own, access, collect, use and dispose minor forest produce. In this area, the collection of MFPs has been prohibited since 2003. In the Sitanadi Udanti Reserve, the plucking of tendu, that is Diospyros melanoxylon, the collection of mahulai, that is Bauhinia wahili, and mahua, Maduka longifolia, and other such produce has been completely prohibited since 2003. It is ₹450 for 100 leaves of tendu today. But the communities living in the 17 village in Udanti and 34 villages in Sitanadi cannot use this opportunity for their betterment because they cannot pluck these leaves from the reserve. Gradually, this has brought an end to the forest-based livelihoods of these people. But if the rights to manage forests and to collect minor forest produce are recognized through community forests right under the Forest Rights Act, then the relationship between forests and communities will only strengthen. The main feature of this law, which is that the Gram Sabha will decide how to conserve and manage forests, and the role of Section 4, Subsection 1, Clause E committees, that is the community forest management committees with 10 to 15 members from the villages that will make management plans. All of this can reduce the conflict that the Indian Forest Act of 1927 had created. The Forest Rights Act has the potential to increase community participation in forest governance while safeguarding community livelihoods and conserving forests. Without the community's contribution and participation, we will not be able to conserve forests, reduce displacement, or abate the impact of climate change. Tribals and other marginalized people are already bearing the brunt of climate change.
Since these ownership rights were recognized under the Forest Rights Act, communities have interfaced with the markets in a variety of ways. In some cases, the Gram Sabhas have taken the initiative to engage directly with the markets to determine price and sustainable harvesting practices. On the other hand, the usual practice where the government has provided labor costs and bonuses to the communities and taken royalties from the sale of minor forest produce remains in operation in several places. When it comes to taking major decisions, whether it is about the price or about regulating harvests, the relative roles of the Gram Sabha and the Forest Department need to be reassessed in light of the community's rights under the Forest Rights Act. Another source of a community's right to manage forests can be the concept of village forest that we noted in relation to the Indian Forest Act. State governments can assign their rights under the Indian Forest Act to govern the rights of settlement, cultivation and harvesting of minor forest produce to local forest-dwelling communities. Once such an assignment of rights happens, and subject to any rules made by the state government in that regard, the village community can begin governing those rights. However, such rules have been criticized for curtailing the rights of local communities and the powers of Gram Sabhas to manage forests and forest produce under the Forest Rights Act. The village forest rules notified by the Maharashtra government in 2014 are a recent example of this. Forest-dwelling communities can also participate in the management of biological resources through biodiversity management committees that have to be constituted by all local bodies in India under the National Biodiversity Act. These committees promote conservation, sustainable use and the documentation of biological diversity, including the preservation of habitats and the conservation of plant varieties bred for cultivation, including by ancient farmers. They can also levy charges on any person for accessing and collecting any biological resource for commercial purposes from areas within its jurisdiction. We learned previously in this module how the National Biodiversity Authority, which is the regulatory body for India's biological resources and knowledge relating to those resources, has the duty to ensure the equitable sharing of the benefits arising from research into and commercial exploitation of biological resources. So when it considers applications for access to these resources or the grant of intellectual property rights based on information or knowledge about these resources, it has to ensure that its approval is only granted subject to conditions that require the equitable sharing of the benefits arising from the use of these biological resources. These conditions must also be in accordance with the terms and conditions that are mutually agreed between the person applying for such approval, the local bodies concerned, and the benefit claimers, who are the conservers of biological resources and holders of knowledge and information relating to the use of such biological resources. Thus, local communities can also participate in the management of biological resources if they are benefit claimers. As conditions of equitable sharing, the National Biodiversity Authority can order the grant of joint ownership rights to benefit claimers. The location of production, research and development units in such areas, which will facilitate better living standards to the benefit claimers, and the payment of monetary compensation and other non-monetary benefits to the benefit claimers. The National Biodiversity Authority can revoke its approval if any of the conditions that it has imposed have not been complied with. While taking any decision relating to the use of biological resources or knowledge associated with such resources occurring within the territorial jurisdiction of a biodiversity management committee, the National Biodiversity Authority and the state biodiversity boards must consult that committee. Let us now move on to the management of spaces in forests that have been earmarked for conservation. These are areas declared as national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, critical tiger habitats, conservation reserves, or community reserves under the Wildlife Protection Act, or as a critical wildlife habitat under the Forest Rights Act. Now, under the PESA law, both Gram Sabhas and Panchayats at the appropriate level have the power in scheduled areas to prevent the alienation of land and to take action to restore illegally alienated land. As we have learnt, the Gram Sabhas also have powers of democratic decision-making to protect wildlife, forests and biodiversity, protect catchment areas, water sources and other ecologically sensitive areas, protect the habitats and heritage of forest-dwelling scheduled tribes, and to ensure that decisions of the Gram Sabhas to regulate access to community forest resources and stop any activity which adversely affects wild animals, forests and biodiversity are complied with. To exercise these powers, the Gram Sabhas can constitute committees for the protection of wildlife, forest and biodiversity from among its members. These committees have to prepare a conservation and management plan for community forest resources, which it then must integrate with the working plans and micro plans of the forest department with any modifications that the committee considers necessary. These are some general powers of the Gram Sabha that local communities can use in the governance of forest areas where a decision has been made under law to use that land for wildlife conservation. In critical tiger habitats, the management of forests and forest resources has to be in accordance with a tiger conservation plan prepared by the state governments. Apart from the requirement that the limits of the buffer areas of these habitats have to be determined in consultation with the concerned Gram Sabhas, local communities have limited rights in the governance of critical tiger habitats. Community reserves and conservation reserves under the Wildlife Protection Act are categories of protected areas where local communities have a greater role in conservation. These areas are typically notified by governments to act as buffer zones for inviolate spaces or as migration corridors between inviolate spaces. To conserve, manage and maintain conservation reserves, the state government has to constitute conservation reserve management committees. Among others, these committees must contain one representative of each village panchayat in whose jurisdiction the reserve is located and three representatives of non-governmental organizations working in the field of wildlife conservation. To conserve, maintain and manage community reserves, the state government has to constitute community reserve management committees. Among others, the committee has to contain five representatives nominated by the village panchayat or by the members of the Gram Sabha where such a panchayat does not exist. In community reserves, the committee is competent to prepare and implement a management plan for the community reserve and to take steps to ensure the protection of wildlife and its habitat in the reserve. These committees are the institutions through which local communities can participate in the management of conservation reserves and community reserves. As you can see, the power of these committees and the power of local communities to influence their composition is most significant in the case of community reserves. Finally, we can look at critical wildlife habitats under the Forest Rights Act. Like critical tiger habitats, the government has to work with local communities to establish critical wildlife habitats. But once they have been established, the Gram Sabhas have limited powers to influence their governance. One condition that the government must abide by is that once forest dwellers are relocated from a critical wildlife habitat, the state or central governments have an obligation to not divert that land for any other use. This obligation can be enforced by local communities through courts. And with that, we come to the end of this lecture on how local communities can participate in the management of forests and forest resources. We looked at three different scenarios. In the first case, we learned how communities can monitor compliance with the conditions of forest clearance after some forest land has been diverted for a non-forest purpose. In the second case, we learned how communities can use their rights and powers to participate in the management of forest areas that have not been specifically earmarked for conservation. They can use the privileges accorded to them under joint forest management policies and their rights to own, manage, and monetize minor forest produce and their rights to participate in the governance of biological resources. In the third case, we learned how communities can participate in the management of conservation spaces through the general powers of the Gram Sabhas and through the committees that manage community reserves and conservation reserves. Thank you for watching.